God, and we're here to celebrate him this morning. So if you would please stand with us. We're just going to awake the worshiper in you. Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand. I want to be standing on your side, holding your hand. So let your kingdom come, let it live in me. This is my prayer, this is my plea. Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand. I want to be standing on your side, holding your hand. So let your kingdom come, let it live in me. This is my prayer, this is my plea. Let the worshipers arise, let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all, I surrender to the King. Father, I hear it growing louder, the song of the redeemed, as the saints of every nation are awakening to sing. And from our hearts there comes an anthem, oh, hear the ring. This is a song to our King. Let the worshipers arise, let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all, I surrender to the King. Worshippers arise, let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all, I surrender to the King. Oh, let the worshippers arise, let the worshippers arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all, I surrender to the King. Amen. Oh, we just welcome everybody here this morning. Oh, we surrender to the King. I surrender to the King. I could just keep singing that song a couple more times, but we got some other things we're going to think about. You know what? God is in the house today, and we're just going to celebrate Him that way, so let's just give Him some praise, even before we sing, because you guys are going to be awesome. But let's go. All right. Kind of a good long intro here, but all right, look at this word. So open our eyes, Lord. We want to see you. And here we go.
Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see you. Open our hearts, Lord. We want to know you. Open our ears, Lord. We need to hear you.
That's right.
Jesus be revealed. Jesus be revealed. God is here. God is here. God is here. He is able. We draw near to see Jesus face to face. God oh, Jesus be revealed.
Open the gates that the Spirit would come in.
Open the gates, Lord. Reveal your glory. Open the nations. Establish your kingdom.
Yes.
Open the heavens. Pour out your Spirit. Jesus be revealed. Be revealed. God is here, God is here, God is here, keep His name, oh. We draw near to see Jesus face to face. God is here, God is here, God is here, keep His faithful. We draw near to see Jesus, oh. Jesus be revealed.
Amen. Oh, we cry holy, let's sing it.
Holy, we cry holy, hallelujah, God is here. Holy, we cry holy, hallelujah, God is here.
One more, let's sing it holy.
Holy, we cry holy, hallelujah, God is here. Holy, we cry holy, hallelujah, God is here. God is here, He is able. We draw near to see Jesus face to face. God is here, God is here, God is here, He is faithful. We draw near to see Jesus, oh, Jesus be revealed.
Amen. Good, good God, and we just serve Him, but I love that He is able and He is faithful, and we just celebrate Him this morning. So here's a oldie but a goodie. It's coming. It's going to be awesome. Lord, we just give You praise this morning. You guys know this one.
Well, I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. Well, I heard about His groaning, of His precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me. sing. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Oh, amen. Before you, and he will fight your battles. Victory in Jesus.
Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love. For me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story, and some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory. Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Good morning, everyone. We're just so glad that you're here. You know, we have the victory in Jesus, so we're glad that you've joined us today. Please be seated, and Todd.
Good morning, good morning. Well, welcome to our Sunday service here at the Free Church of Lander. If you're a first-timer or just checking us out, we've got a connections table out in the foyer. We'd ask that you just stop by, pick up some information there. There's a lot of stuff that's going on here that is going on throughout the week that would be great to be able to plug into. Last night, we had a really resounding, I think, success with the Nerds and Cornhole Tournament. So thanks to the Murnos, Witzkies, and Drayson for putting all that together. But anyway, so just check that place out because there's a lot of stuff that's going on that I think you just need to check in on. Plus, we also have a free gift for you, too. So there's also a printed copy of the email that we send out every week that if you have trouble just printing it off or seeing it or whatever, we've got a printed copy out there. And if you just want to get put on the email list, just, again, stop by the connections table, give me your information so that you can put on that. And to help me with announcements, we've got a really cool announcement by Mr. Dolance here. So Larry, would you tell us all about it?
Thanks, Todd. Good morning, all, y'all. That was my big takeaway from last Sunday's sermon. I have some really good news.
Yes.
And the good news is beginning next Sunday and every communion Sunday, first Sunday of the month, we're going to have a men's breakfast. And men's breakfast, okay? Very simple format. Man, food. Man, food. Okay, and in between, we're going to eat and talk and get to know each other a little bit. We're going to begin at, I think the bulletin said 8, but it's more like 7:30. The bigger portions will be served at 7:30. We hope to have everybody out by 8:45 or so, so that we can take advantage of the extra hour and pick up the family or do whatever else we're going to do. Now, the dress is going to be informal. Todd, you can wear your suit if you want. But in general, it'll be informal. It'll be for men, and the free church view on men is 12 and above. So if you have teenage sons, bring them along. We would love to have your teenage sons come along. And if you teenagers have friends, bring them along as well, as long as they're not girls. Bring the boys. Now, we need a little bit of help from the women. Now, I know you're thinking, what a chauvinistic thing. No. Listen up. Let's finish here. We're liberated men. We can do kitchen work. We're going to do the dishes. But you might have a guy that's kind of like me, a little kind of shy, introverted, wallflower, and he might need some encouragement to come. Next Saturday night, you remind him. Sunday morning, 7:30 here. You need to be out there. You're going to have a good time with some guys, learn a little bit of stuff. You're going to be involved with the Christian love, and it's all going to be covered in nice bacon grease. So it's going to be pretty good. And if your guy's one of those that's kind of out there a little bit and needs to get reeled in back into his shell, we can help you with that as well. So what we're asking is about 7:30 next week, somewhere in that area, show up in the back here in the fellowship hall, and we'll have an opportunity then to kind of sit down, and it's free. Just come on, bring your friend, and we'll have a good time.
Great. Thank you very much, sir. Well, blessings come in all shapes and sizes. Our God loves us so very much and just desires to pour out all his blessings on us. The question that we should constantly or just be daily asking ourselves is, are we recognizing the gifts? God blesses us physically, spiritually, and I often find myself in prayer and reflecting on all the wonderful things God does for me and what he does around me. And for most of us, there's a lot out there that's just competing for our mind space. In most cases, I feel like that's when the evil one is at the work in most in our lives. Drowning out the quiet time that we spend with our Father in prayer and filling it with what we need to do next or what we need to acquire. But just to stop, to pause, to look around, and just thank the Lord for all that he does. Whether it be a place to call home, a spouse to kiss, a parent or kid to love, a job, a church, beautiful trees and mountains, creatures, friendships, experiences, which both include the good ones and the bad ones, and on. But at the very top of the long list is the greatest blessing of them all, which is Jesus dying on the cross to take away our sins, to be forgiven, and to be made right in the presence of our Lord. So as we open up our service in prayer, I'd like to turn to just a very short, simple verse that Paul wrote to the Philippians in chapter 4, verse 19. And I think it just really sums it up. It's short. And my God will meet all of your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. Would you please pray with me? Father, thank you so much for this beautiful day. Thank you for all the blessings that you pour out on us each and every day of our lives. Father, we pray that we'll never take you for granted, that we'll never forget all the good things and challenging experiences come from. Father, we know your love for us is never-ending. It's limitless. Lord, we know that you will provide us everything we could ever need. We're thankful every day for your greatest gift, and that is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, as he took away our sins so we could be forgiven, so that one day we may live with you in your heavenly kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Of our God.
there's nothing that could separate us. I love that part. And then it says, no life, no death. Of this I am convinced. You know, we have a response to that if we're convinced that there's nothing that can separate us. And it's take my life. If you guys would stand with us one more time. And let these words just kind of sink in as you sing them. Lord, I'm yours, set apart for you.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Let them flow in ceaseless praise.
Take my hands.
Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Swift and beautiful for thee.
I am yours,
set apart. Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from
holy. Lord, we just give you praise and honor this morning. I just thank you for the church that we have to come to and the spirit that you pour out into us. Lord, help us to hear and see what we've got next in scripture. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Would you guys please be seated? Thank you.
You sit there with Brett. They're just going to put a couple there. Or do you want to take that one with Brett?
Yeah.
Okay.
chair. Haven't seen it yet this morning.
Welcome to church. Morning, everyone. Good to see you all here. How you doing?
Good.
You're right. She did sneak in before you, Zach. Whew. Morning, Kittrey. Good to see you.
All right. We're going to be in the book of Leviticus today. And as we start, while I'm giving the introduction, open your Bibles to Leviticus chapter 1. And then I also would like you to put the little tassel maybe you have in your Bible. Those of you who have an electronic Bible, sorry. Put that tassel in Isaiah chapter 1. And then put your mask, if you took your mask off, in Hebrews chapter 10. That's where we're going to be today. And that way you can flip quickly when we go there, okay? So again, Leviticus, we're going to start in chapter 1 today. Isaiah chapter 1, put your tassel, and then Hebrews chapter 10, go ahead and put something there, okay? Sound good? My name's Rich, I'm one of the pastors here at church. For those of you who haven't had a chance to meet me, welcome to church. We're glad to see you here with us today, worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ. We worship God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit in this church. One God, three parts, all together, and we just do this for the glory of the Lord Jesus. Many of you have heard Christianity is not a religion, it's a relationship. And you're wondering, why are we in Leviticus? And we covered that a little bit last week, didn't we? We talked about how all of the Old Testament is the scriptures that can make us wise unto salvation, because all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness so that the man of God, you women too, may be equipped for every good work. Right? And so we're going to be in the book of Leviticus, and what we're going to learn is that in Leviticus, God starts to reveal his plan about how he is going to save lost mankind. Because God had a plan. His plan was to live with man in the garden, but man's got a problem, and we call that problem sin. But God's got a solution, and that solution is what we call the Lord Jesus Christ. And all we have to do, well, man's got a response. Anybody ever heard what those are? That little thing I'm using, the four spiritual laws? You might have heard that before. So that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about how God begins to reveal in the book of Leviticus his plan to save mankind from their sin. Next slide, please. Leviticus. We looked a little bit about the structure and the background of the book, and it was kind of interesting because this book is divided into seven parts. And chapters 1 through 7, that's what we're going to go through today. Yes, chapters 1 through 7. We're going to go fast, don't worry. But we'll go through chapters 1 through 7. That's about ritual sacrifices. And over on the far end of the book, we have this ritual calendar. And these are kind of like bookends. And then we move in a little bit. And over here, we have the priest's ordination in the next section. That'll be next Sunday. And then at the end of the book, but just in from that part, we have all of the priest's qualifications. And then we move in again, one more, and we have ritual purity, and then we have moral purity. And all of this centers on this thing called the Day of Atonement. So the whole book is pointing to this thing called the Day of Atonement. And we talked about how this is a little bit of a mountain, kind of pointing us up to God. And interestingly enough, if we look at the Old Testament, if we look at the first five books of Moses, the Pentateuch, or the Law, as it's called, we have Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Right? So the whole law is pointing to Leviticus, and Leviticus is pointing to this Day of Atonement. And for those of us who now live post-resurrection of Jesus Christ, we know about that Day of Atonement that all of this is pointing forward to. And so Leviticus, that's how we're gonna split it up today as we discuss it. Next slide, please. Last week we closed with what do? Because we're now post-Christian era Christians. We are now Christians. We're not Jews back in the time. We're not going to slaughter a bunch of animals, although Jared is in the next room, so if any of you need some cows slaughtered, I did get to meet Jared Hamilton today, and he's right over there. He could come in and do this professionally, and I think Todd might be pretty good at it as well, and maybe Rod, some of the other guys. But we are called to recognize and respond in obedience, just like Israel was. But obedience is not about achieving or pleasing God. Obedience is about living a life of distinctness. I mean, we can all look at the world around us right now, and we see lots of rebellion going on, even in our own United States, where people are not, you know, doing the things that we would expect them to do. And law is being challenged, even today. We're to live a life that demonstrates, as the Israelites were called to, we are to live a life that demonstrates God is in our midst. Don't y'all know, right, that y'all are the temple of God and that he lives in y'all, right? And so that's where we were last week. Now we're going to actually open the book of Leviticus and we're going to continue through. Please open your Bibles to Leviticus chapter 1. And as we get there, anytime we're reading the Old Testament, I mentioned this last weekend, I'll probably mention it a few more times, the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed, and the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. So when we study the Old Testament, we're also going to look at what is coming out in the New as well. And so you'll see that. We'll tie this all in together, okay? Leviticus chapter 1. We're going to start, next slide please, honey. We're going to start in verse 3. If his offering is a burnt offering from the herd, he shall offer a male without blemish. He shall bring it to the entrance of the tent of meeting, that he may be accepted before the Lord. He shall lay his hand on the head of the burnt offering, and it shall be accepted for him to make atonement for him. Okay, what is this looking forward to? What do we have revealed to us? We know that Jesus is this perfect offering. And we see that in the book of Hebrews, in Hebrews chapter 9. Jesus is perfect. He is without sin. We have a great high priest who is tempted in every way like us, but without sin. Next slide, please. Slide down to verse 9. I told you we're going to go fast, folks, so hold on and we'll get going. Verse 9. But its entrails, its legs, he shall wash with water, and the priest shall burn it. The priest shall burn all of it on the altar as a burnt offering, a food offering, with a pleasing aroma for the Lord. It's very important not to miss that little word, all. The priest is to burn all of it, and that is symbolic of complete consecration to the Lord. We are called to be that. We are called to be completely, 100%, everything that is us is going to be consecrated to him. Next slide, please. In 10 and 14, in there, it says if his gift is from the flock or if it's a burnt offering of birds. So you don't have to give a bull of the herd. A bull's pretty expensive, right? Sherry, how expensive is a bull? You know, I bet. But you can also give a burnt offering from the flock, a goat or a sheep. And if you have to, you can give a bird. That's okay, too. The amount of the offering is tied to the economic status of the person. And this is important because, again, as we open this up, we see that God applies this to himself. And God will give a sacrifice of infinite value, because he's the infinite God as well. Next slide, please. Leviticus chapter 6 and 7 comment on chapters 1 through 5. And we'll see that. And so what we see in 6, as it discusses the law of the burnt offering, it says that the burnt offering must be on the hearth of the altar all night. And the fire cannot go out. It must be kept burning. This is symbolic of perpetual consecration to the Lord. Always, every day, ongoing, we are to be completely, we saw that all of the burnt offering is on the altar, but we are not only to do all of us, but every single day. Next slide, please. So to sum up chapter 1, the burnt offering is the way to say, I'm sorry. And it's offered for general sinfulness. Lord, I'm sorry about all of the sins I commit each and every day. The animal is given to make atonement for you. You are now ransomed by a substitute. You no longer receive what you deserve. We called that what last week? Does anyone remember? Not getting what you deserve is called mercy. Getting what you don't deserve is called grace. Very good. So mercy is not getting what I deserve. Grace is getting what I do not deserve. Little tricky words there. The entire animal is on the altar for the entire day and night. It's a continual thing. Think smoked brisket, right? Takes a long time to get that sucker going right, doesn't it? And so that's what's going on. The New Testament, how does this comment on this? What is this revealing? When Paul writes Romans chapter 12, verse 1, which is a very familiar verse to many of us, this is what he's thinking about. Therefore, my dear brothers, offer yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to the Lord. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. Offer yourselves as a living, a complete and perpetual sacrifice. That's what we see in Leviticus chapter 1. Next slide. Let's go to chapter 2. There's this other offering, and there's 5 offerings, folks, and we're going to go through them quickly. There's what we call the grain offering. Leviticus chapter 2, verse 1. When anyone brings a grain offering as an offering to the Lord, his offering shall be of fine flour. He shall put oil on it and put frankincense on it and bring it to Aaron's sons, the priests. The frankincense, that's the incense that is often offered with an offering. Anybody here like the smell of burnt toast? No. If you burn flour, it's probably not going to be a pleasing aroma to the Lord. But we also remember in Philippians, and Todd read from Philippians 4:19 today during the invocation. He didn't know that I was going to go to Philippians 4:18. But right before that, Paul writes to the Philippians that this is a fragrant offering. Again, this is what Paul's thinking. He's thinking about how the offering is made fragrant. Next slide, please. And this is verses 2 through 3. Again, you're to bring it to Aaron, the sons of the priest, and he shall take from it a handful of the fine flour and oil with all of its frankincense, and the priest shall burn it, this as its memorial portion on the altar, a food offering with a pleasing aroma to the Lord. But the rest of the grain offering shall be for Aaron and his sons. It is the most holy part of the Lord's food offering. So of a grain offering, you burn a memorial piece, but most of it is given to the priests. This is part of the Lord's provision for the priests. The priests are not to be doing labor outside of the church. They're not to be doing labor outside of the temple because they're to be consecrated to the Lord. And so they're not to do common labor. They're to do only what's considered holy labor. Next slide, please. In 4 through 7, and you don't need to turn there, you can also, you don't have to give just flour. You can give loaves or wafers that are smeared with oil. You can make an offering baked on a griddle. What would we call that? Pancakes. Yeah, men's breakfast, right? That's what we're going to be doing. We're going to be making a grain offering to the Lord. You can also have it cooked in a pan. Maybe that's pancakes. I don't care. Maybe it's pan is bacon. No, it's supposed to be grain. Sorry. But it's supposed to be with oil. All of the grain offerings are supposed to be made with oil, which is symbolic of anointing of the Holy Spirit. Right? And we've all read about oil. And that's what it's looking forward to. Jesus is the Messiah. What does the word Messiah mean? What? Come on, speak up. What does it mean? He's our Savior. But the word Messiah means anointed one. That's what it means. So he's anointed by the Holy Spirit. Remember, the dove comes down at his baptism and is over him? That's symbolic of Jesus' anointing. Next slide. No leaven nor honey. Season it with salt. And I don't know about you, you scratch your heads. Many of us who've been around church for a while, we know that leaven is supposed to be representative or symbolic of sin and honey. Both of these things are tied to fermentation and putrefaction. And what we draw from this visual illusion is that sin rots the entire body of believers. Your personal sin is not your own thing between you and God. We are a community. Israel was a community, and they were called to worship God. When one man sinned, the whole community suffered. Achan, they cross the Jordan River. They go to the Battle of Jericho. Joshua fought the Battle of Jericho, right? Y'all remember that story? And after that, they go to this next town. It's the pirate city of Ai. Ai, that's what it's called. I don't know how to pronounce it. Ai, I just like to say that because it sounds cool and the kids like it. You know, the pirate city of Ai. They went up to the pirate city of Ai and they got their handed to them. And it didn't go well because Achan had sinned. So you can read that in Joshua, I think it's chapter 7 and 8. They talk about that. Our sin affects the whole body. Because we relate to you, and when sin is inside of us, we got to get it out. Right? And that's what this is all talking about as we look forward to that. Salt, on the other hand, that's symbolic in the Old Testament of permanence. It's symbolic of incorruption. And God will often say he's made a covenant of salt with you, meaning an unchanging covenant. In 2 Chronicles, that covenant is made with David. And we know that he makes a covenant with David that you will have an heir on the throne forever. And I make this as a covenant of salt. Next slide. Grain offerings, in summary, it's a voluntary way to say thank you to God. You're giving back some of what he's given to you. Some is for the Lord and some is for the priest. There's that memorial portion. In the New Testament, where do we see that? We see this in tithing. Tithing is how we respond in this way today. Some of you may go, no, Pastor Rich, I've heard them say that there's no tithing in the New Testament. I'd encourage you to write down those two little references that are up there on the screen, because Jesus actually approves of tithing. He affirms that the Levites and the priests do tithe, and they should. And so you should, is his own words. But also remember, tithing's not just about your money. Tithing's about your time, your talent, and your treasure. So as you think about giving back to the Lord what he's given you, remember, he's given us every breath we take. Right? And some of us, as we get older and older, we really recognize that more and more, don't we? Give a little bit of your time in service to the kingdom. Give a little bit of your talent in service to the kingdom. And give a little bit of your treasure in service of the kingdom as well. Next slide. We're going to go to 3, Leviticus chapter 3, verse 1. If his offering is a sacrifice of peace offering, if he offers an animal of the herd, male or female, he shall offer it without blemish before the Lord. And he shall lay his hand on the head of his offering and kill it at the entrance of the tent of meeting. And Aaron's sons and the priests shall throw the blood. I know this is nasty stuff, isn't it? It's like, no, don't kill my pet cow. And from the sacrifice of the peace offering as a food offering to the Lord, he shall offer the fat covering the entrails and all the fat that is on the entrails and the two kidneys with all the fat that is with them on the loins and all the long lobe of the liver that he shall remove with all the kidneys. How many of you are happy that we get to sacrifice the lobe of the liver, right? Woohoo! Don't eat it. My mother was British. She made me eat liver. She tried to feed me kidneys once. I told her, Mom, you need to go back and read your Bible. Of course, I did not say that. Fat symbolizes the best of the animal. That's what we're actually seeing, the most nutritious. Yes, Mother, liver is nutritious, right? And my British mother tried to tell me that kidneys is nutritious as well. But praise the Lord, she only made that once, and I pitched such a fit, she didn't want to fight that fight again. So, whew, got out of that. But that's what we're looking at. We see this in Genesis. When Jacob's family comes down to Egypt because Joseph has been raised to be the second greatest ruler in Egypt, he brings his family down, and they go out into Goshen, and they are given to live off the fat of the land. So that's what that fat, it's all symbolic of the very best. God will give his very best as well, will he not? Next slide, please. Leviticus 7 comments on this. You don't need to turn there. It talks about these offerings are to be eaten on the day of the offering. The person who's actually offering the peace offering or the fellowship offering is another term for it, is actually eating most of the meat with his family there at the temple. Some goes to the priest. A little bit of it goes to the priest, but you are to eat this. This is a fellowship meal, one with the other. Next slide. So the peace offering is a voluntary way to say thank you. It's a meal shared with God. And it's a meal shared with one another. Some shared with the priests. Some is shared with your family or your brothers and sisters in Christ who have brought. What do we have in the New Testament? Well, we have our Lord's Supper. Is that not a meal that we share with God? Is that not a practice where in his presence we break bread and drink wine? And when we do this in remembrance of him, the Lord Jesus. That's what we see. This is all looking forward to our Christian practice, is it not? Next slide, please. All right, chapter 4. We're going to keep going. In chapter 4, verse 2, it says, if anyone sins unintentionally in any of the Lord's commandments about the things not to be done and does any one of them. Unintentionally. This is the Hebrew word bisagaga. I love that word. Bisagaga. If anyone wanders off like a sheep. And we all know that we are all sheep of his pasture. And sometimes we go astray. We sin unintentionally. Next slide, please. Well, what are you to give? You're to give the fat and the kidneys and the liver, praise the Lord. And all the rest of it is carried by the priest outside of the camp to a clean place, and he burns it up with fire. So again, all of this is burned up with fire, completely consecrated to the Lord. This is not a fellowship offering. This is an offering for sin. And when you've committed a sin unintentionally, but now you've realized it, then we need to get things right with God. And this is how it's done. We also need to get things right with one another. And we'll talk about that in just a moment. This represents the best, though. Again, the offering is the fat and the kidneys and the liver. And that gets burned up on the altar by the priest. But the rest of it is not shared because this is an offering for sin. This is like blood money, if you can think about it that way. Remember blood money? They took the 30 pieces of silver and they didn't put it back into the treasury, right? Because that was blood money. So we don't do that. We don't eat this as a fellowship offering. It's for specific sin, and it's a complete offering once again. Next slide, please. Interestingly enough, in this section, if you run through all of these verses, it says that if the anointed priest does this, he has to bring a bull. Whew. He has to get his wallet out and write a big check. And if the whole congregation does it, same thing. It's a big deal. You need a bull. If it's a leader can offer a goat, but it has to be a male. And if it's just a common person, meaning just one of us, well, that person can offer a goat and it could be a female. And so we see that the cost is related to your social standing and your influence. And there is a greater cost, is there not? When leaders fail morally, do things that are inappropriate legally, we hold them to a very high account, do we not? But it impacts everyone else that they're leading, does it not? And we've seen this, unfortunately, in the church. We've seen it in governments. We've seen it in history as well. Next slide, please. What are some of these things? We get some examples of this in Leviticus chapter 5. If you hear a public adoration to testify, so they call for witnesses. You're a witness, and you don't speak up at first. None of us like to do that. None of us like to stand up and speak up against someone, right? And sometimes we kind of hold back. And apparently they did this then. If you touch human uncleanness unintentionally, if you utter a rash oath with your lips, these are just examples of sin. Sin, though, really is the best example I ever heard was not doing what I should and doing what I shouldn't. So if you really, that's a great way, I think, to summarize what is sin. So if you do something you should not, or you fail to do something you shouldn't, that's a sin. And when you realize it, we need to deal with that. Next slide. If you can't afford a lamb, you can offer two turtle doves or two pigeons. If you can't afford two turtle doves or two pigeons, you can offer a tenth of an ephah of fine flour. The financial status can modify it. If you can't afford a bull, and brothers and sisters in Christ, there are some pastors out there who are leaders, they can't afford a bull. But God says, I got that. He's not interested in your wallet. He's got the cattle on 1,000 hills. Right? He doesn't need our animals. He doesn't need our money. Right? What he's really interested in is a repentant heart. And so he's not going to latch you onto something that you just cannot handle. Next slide, please. The purification offering is a way of saying, I'm sorry. It's to make atonement for you. The offering is linked to your social status, and the entire animal is on the altar. And in the New Testament, we hear echoes of this because we're told in the book of Hebrews that leaders are called to a higher account. Right? Be careful, you leaders, because you will give an accounting for your flock before the Lord. And that kind of scares me. God says, hey, Rich, I want you to move you and your family. I want you to head over to Lander. And I said, okay. I like Lander. My sister lives there. It's pretty. And he says, yeah, I got 175 people. Whoa, ho, ho, 175 souls? Prayer and fasting went into that, let me tell you. Praise the Lord for a great set of elders, right, who can bear that burden with me. And I appreciate that. But the elders are in the same boat I am, aren't we, Jace? Aren't we, Todd? And aren't we Norm? Yes, Norm is not serving as an elder, but he is an elder of this church. That doesn't go away, right? We're called to give an account. Fathers, husbands, mothers, right? We all give an account as well. So this isn't just limited to you know, guys like me. Next slide, please. What are some of the things in the next and final offering? Whew! Rich is going to end. Turn to chapter 6. Chapter 6, verses 2 through 6. If anyone commits a sin and commits a breach of faith against the Lord by deceiving his neighbor in a matter of deposit or security, or through robbery, or if he has oppressed his neighbor, or has found something lost and lied about it, swearing falsely, if any of all the things that people do and sin thereby, if he has sinned and has realized his guilt and will restore what he took by robbery, or what he got by oppression, or the deposit that was committed to him, or the lost things that was found, or anything about which he has sworn falsely, he shall restore it in full and add a fifth to it. Whew. And give it to him to whom it belongs on the day he realizes his guilt. And he shall bring to the priest as his compensation to the Lord a ram without blemish out of the flock or its equivalent for a guilt offering. This is for the intentional sin. This is a little different than the unintentional sin. And it gives some examples in the scripture. But if you've done something against your neighbor, against your brother and sister in Christ, or against somebody in Safeway, or on the highway, or in school, or on the playground. They got me off the playground really early, by the way. There's a two-step process here. You're to get things right with God. You have to bring your offering to the Lord, but you also must make restitution and add a fifth to it. Why are we adding a fifth? Why do you think? These are not rhetorical questions. Why do you think God wants us to add a fifth? If I held back your security deposit, and then I said, hey, guess what? I'm going to give you your security deposit back, and I'm going to give you another $500. I shouldn't have done that. You know what? The carpets were actually clean. I shouldn't have told you, no, the carpets aren't clean. And I did that was wrong. Why do I add a fifth? How would you feel if I did that? Bewildered. Yeah, the whole world would feel a little bewildered. Would you feel that I'm sincere in my apology? Wouldn't that demonstrate sincerity in an apology? If I said, not only am I going to give back to you what I stole from you, but I'm actually going to add something to it. That's the whole idea here. This is to show you are sincere to others. Next slide. All right, that's it. Woo, yes. We have five big offerings. We have the burnt offering, and that's a way of saying, sorry, Lord, for my general sinfulness. We have the grain offering. That's a way of saying, thank you, Lord. We also have the peace offering. Thank you, Lord. And we come together. The purification offering for my unintentional sin. And we have the restitution offering for my intentional sins. And that's a way of saying, sorry, my brother or sister. And also, sorry, Lord. What we see in Leviticus with this whole sacrificial system thing, this is all about restoring and maintaining relationship. God is trying to get this agrarian culture to understand that he is going to restore the relationship that has been broken by sin. And he's going to provide the means by which this relationship can be maintained. Next slide, please. All of this relationship was supposed to do something, though. The Israelites were supposed to recognize and respond in obedience. Let's open up. Remember, I asked you to go to Isaiah. This is when we're going to Isaiah. Whew. Let's see how this worked out. Thank you, Zoe. Well, she went to children's church. I have her bookmarker. That was my little thing. Thank you. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 11. Isaiah's at the very end of Israel's time, right before the exile. And he's talking about the exile itself. And this is what Isaiah is told by God to write down. Again, these are God's words. God says, what to me is your multitude of sacrifices, says the Lord. I've had enough of burnt offerings and rams and the fat of well-fed beasts. I do not delight in the blood of bulls or of lambs or of goats. When you come to appear before me, who has required you this trampling in my courts? Bring no more vain offerings. Incense is an abomination to me. New moon and Sabbath and the calling of convocations, I cannot endure iniquity and the solemn assembly. Your new moons and your appointed feasts my soul hates. They have become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them. When you spread out your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood. Wash yourselves. Make yourselves clean. Remove the evil of your deeds from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do good. Seek justice. Correct oppression. Bring justice to the fatherless and plead the widow's cause. All of this was supposed to teach Israel how to love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. And they failed to do it. This sacrificial system, they didn't get it. Next slide. So what did God do about that? Hebrews chapter 10. Let's go there. We love the book of Hebrews because Hebrews actually almost directly comments on all of the stuff from the first century temple worship. And so we'll be in Hebrews a lot. Next slide, please. In Hebrews 4 and 9, it says, it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. And so Jesus, that's my little input there, this is my link to 9, he does away with the first order in order to establish the second. So the sacrificial system has been put aside in our time today. And Jesus establishes a new one. Next slide. And so in verse 19, in chapter 10, verse 19, we'll begin to read. Therefore, brothers, based upon the fact that Jesus has come, died, was buried, resurrected, and ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. Based upon all of that which we've now discussed in chapters 7 through 9 of the book of Hebrews. Therefore, brothers, since we now have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is through his flesh, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir one another up for love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. I like to call this the salad verse. Let us, let us, let us. What are we to do? We're to draw near with a true heart of faith. Faith, we've heard that before. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope. And let us consider how to stir one another up to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meeting together. We're to love one another. Faith, hope, and love. We've heard those before if you've been around church. And if you haven't, keep coming. You will. Next slide. Jesus is our burnt offering. And he has given wholly, completely for sinful man. He's our grain offering. He's the bread of life upon which we must feed. He's our peace offering through whom we now can have fellowship with God. He's our purification offering, by whose blood we are cleansed. And he's our restitution offering. He paid the price for all of our sin. Next slide. What does it look like when we live a life that reveals that Jesus is the sacrifice upon which my salvation depends. Close your eyes for a moment, if you would, please. Come, Holy Spirit. Is there a relationship that you need to make right? Is there someone in a family or in your workplace or in your school, in your moving around lander? Are we living a life where we come together and love the Lord our God with all of our heart and all of our soul? Are we loving our neighbors as ourselves? Lord, Holy Spirit. Lord Jesus, God our Father, illuminate in our hearts that which we have not done well, that which we might have failed to do. Help each of us as we strive to serve you, to say thank you, to be in fellowship with you, Lord God, and with one another. Cleanse our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Also, praise the Lord, there are many relationships that you guys are doing well also, aren't they? Many of you are loving the way we're supposed to love. Right? This is not just a message of condemnation. This is also a message of encouragement. Praise the Lord for the good things we do well. Praise the Lord, this church does love people. Do we not? Let's continue. Thank you, Brother Norm. Let's continue to do that as we worship the Lord in song.
Would you guys rise with us? We're just going to stand. This is going to be kind of our Leviticus song for a little bit. It's called The God of Abraham. Maybe you've heard it. We've switched the pronouns to be a little more inclusive for us as we sing it as a church. God of Abraham, and he's in command of every throne. He's the God of majesty. You are the God of Abraham. You are in command of every throne. You are the God of majesty. You saw the heart in me. Made a home. You have been my God, faithful through the years. The nations rise and fall, you were standing still. And you will be our God, what then shall we fear? We know whatever comes, you'll be with us still. You are
boundless grace, and in my darkest days, you still hold on. And you have been our God, faithful through the years. The nations rise and fall, you were standing still. And you will be our God, and what then shall we fear? We know whatever comes, you'll be with us still. I know you never let go. I know you never let go of me. I know you never let go, and you never will. I know you never let go. I know you never let go of me. I know you never let go, and you never will. We know you'll never let go. We know you never let go of me. We know you never let go, and you never will. We know you never let go. We know you never let go of us. We know you never let go, and you never will. You have been our God, faithful through the years. The nations rise and fall, you were standing still. You will be our God, and what then shall we fear? We know whatever comes, you'll be with us still. You have been our God, faithful through the years. The nations rise and fall, you were standing still. And you will be our God, and what then shall we fear? We know whatever comes, you'll be with us still. We know whatever comes, you'll be with us still. We know whatever comes, you'll be with us still.
Whatever comes, he'll be with us still. I hope you guys have a great Sunday, and just be blessed knowing that as a believer in Christ, he is with you. You will be my God. Two, you guys have a great Sunday. Thank you. I've been walking through this life, feeling empty on the inside. Just when I thought my hope had died, you were there to bring me back to life. You awake my love, you renew my strength, you restore my heart. Desperate for a new start. That's when you're